Okay, good morning, church. Just so excited to be back in the house of the Lord and to worship God this morning. And we're on the eve of revival, and I'm excited about that. And I hope you are too. And let me take this time just to welcome you out. We're going to begin tonight at 6 o'clock. And then we got Vacation Bible School coming up the 31st of this month, and I'm very excited about that. And I hope you can join us for that. It'll be on Saturday from 10 o'clock to 4. So bring your kids out. We got plenty of games and food and all kinds of activities, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it. At this time, if you will, let's stand as we salute our flags and we'll begin our service. The Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for the kingdom of saints, one brotherhood, united all mankind, in service and in love. The Bible. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp to my feet, a light unto my path, hide its words in my heart, that I might not sin against God. The American flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'm missing my song leader this morning, Brother Randy Ash. He's out on a mission this morning, and he's going to be bringing us back a report come Vacation Bible School. So you all keep him in your prayers that God will give him the fruit to his labor, okay? So Brother David Combs, he'll be taking over in his place this morning.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It's been a while. Bear with me. But if you would, turn your hymnals to hymn number 153. Number 153. And at the beginning, at the top of the page, you'll find responsive reading. And I would like for us to stand as we read this responsive reading. And the title of it is A Friend Like No Other. And that's what we're going to be singing about this morning. There is no friend like Jesus. Amen. So if you would stand with me, and we'll recite the responsive reading, and I will begin. For there is one God, and one mediator between God and man, a man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all.
No one has greater love than this, that someone would lay down his life for his friends.
I do not call you slaves anymore, because a slave doesn't know what his master is doing. I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. Amen. Amen. Please stand. Remain standing with us. And let's sing 153, The Lily of the Valley.
I have found a friend in Jesus, he's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world for
Page 154, song some of you probably don't even need the hymnal for. What a friend we have in Jesus. This will be our offertory hymn, so we'll ask the ushers to come forward when we get to the third verse.
What a friend we have in Jesus. Our sins and griefs to
your throne this morning. We come with thankful hearts. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being in your house.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you for all those who have come out this morning. We just pray that your Holy Spirit would just flow down among us, Lord, and fill each heart here.
Yes.
Father, as we now take up the offerings and tithes, we ask that you would bless them as well as the giver, Father. Guide and direct us and speak to us through your messenger, Brother David. Lord, we'll always give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for all that you do. For it's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Such a beautiful song, isn't it? And I hope that's our prayer this morning, that God would revive us again. So glad that you're here. It's so wonderful to have our new family back with us today. If you have your Bibles, and I trust that you do, let's go to Psalms chapter 85. Psalms chapter 85. And we're going to begin our reading in verse 1 through verses 13. As always, when you find your place, we'll stand as we reference the reading of the Word of God. A Psalm of the Sons of Korah. The Bible says, excuse me, Lord, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. Thou hast forgiven the iniquity of thy people. Thou hast covered all of their sins, Shelah. And thou hast taken away
all thy wrath. Thou hast turned thyself from thy fierceness of thine anger. Turn us, O God of our salvation, and cause thine anger towards us to cease. Wilt thou be angry with us forever? Wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Show us thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation. I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints, but let them not turn again to folly. Surely his salvation is nigh them that fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth are meet together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall bring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yea, the Lord shall give that which is good, and our land shall yield her increase. Righteousness shall go before him, and shall sit his or shall set us in the way of his steps. Heavenly Father, Lord, as it's already been said, it is so good to be here in your presence and among your people as we worship you in spirit and truth, God. We thank you for all good things, and we thank you for your grace, and thank you for being so kind and loving towards us. God, as we are on the threshold of revival, Lord, let it begin with me. I earnestly desire to be revived. Revive our heart and our soul and our spirits, God, and help us to walk in revival every single day of our lives. Lord, for Brother Greg, as we so often said, he cannot bring revival. Revival must already begin in the hearts of your people, God. Lord, we pray that you would help me this morning to be able to preach your word in such a way that it would be well-pleasing with thee, and that it would be beneficial for your people. Once again, we just pray for the sick. We lift them all up to you. And God, may you get the glory out of everything that's done and said here this morning. For it's in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Once again, the church sounded so good this morning, the choir. And I just appreciate that so much. Again, as we look over our text this morning, Psalms 85, we see a plea for revival, a prayer for revival, and a proclamation for revival. The psalmist prays for revival in their spirits and a renewal of their land. He also pledges that God will again demonstrate his covenant love towards Israel. God had been merciful in the past. At the present, he is angry. But he sees that God will restore again their land, especially in the near future, as we think about the millennial kingdom. So this was a very painful, very difficult time for God's people. Most of you Bible scholars believe that Psalms 85 was written sometime after the Babylonian captivity, as they were in bondage to the Babylonians for 70 years. And don't know exactly the time frame that it was pinned down, but it was in relation to that. And again, as we go over a couple of verses here, I really want to focus my attention on verses 4 through 6. But he says, Lord, as he looks back now, okay, the psalmist, he's looking back. He says, Lord, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. Thou hast forgiven thy iniquity of thy people. Thou hast covered all of thy sins, Selah. And that word there is calling to attention on what has already been said. It's causing us to, or challenging us to pause and to meditate upon verse 2. So you know what, friends, listen. God had forgiven them of their iniquity and of their sins. But you know what? When I look at verse 2, I just thank my Jesus that because of what he did on Calvary's cross some 2,000 years ago, because he chose to die for you and I and shed his blood, we can have forgiveness of all of our iniquities and all of our sins. and the precious blood that he shed upon Calvary's cross. When you and I come to the Lord Jesus in prayer, and we say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Come into my heart and save my soul. Jesus forgives us of all of our sins from past, present, and future. Now, there's a lot of people has a problem with that. But you know what? That's not my problem. That's just Bible. And you know, I thought so often that if sin could penetrate through the blood of Jesus Christ, then it is not as powerful, pure, holy as we think it is. But you know what, friends? Let me be the first to say that the blood of Jesus is powerful. That the blood of Jesus is pure. That the blood of Jesus is holy. And that the blood of Jesus has washed our sins away. Amen. And you know what, friends? I rejoice in that. Now, again, Paul reminded the church at Rome not to use their liberty that they have in the Lord Jesus Christ as an excuse to sin. And you know, friends, you've heard me say this many times. We don't have an excuse to sin. We cannot use God's grace as a crutch to sin. But you know what? I rejoice and I thank God that when we do mess up, well, we can come to the Lord Jesus and confess our sins. And we can find forgiveness. And that's so beautiful. And I love it. Amen. So the psalmist, as he prays for revival, and the word revival, or that word revive in the Hebrew, it just simply means to restore. Restore some things that has been lost. And you know, Jesus, if you remember, in John 10:10, he says that the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. The psalmist is asking, wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Can I say that this is an element that's missing in a lot of Christians' lives today, is joy. Joy is the second fruit of the Spirit. Paul says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. But joy is the second fruit of the Spirit. It's something that a lot of Christians has lost today. Amen. It's something that a lot of churches has lost today. There is no joy in the believer's life anymore. And then we cry out, God, will thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Amen. You know, you remember the joy that you had when God forgave you of your sins when you was first introduced to your wonderful Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Do you remember the joy that you had there the very moment you called upon God? Friends, can I ask you this morning, do you still have that same joy? Or has the enemy stolen it from you? Amen. He pours out his heart before God. We can see him praying and pleading, oh God, will thou not revive us again? Friends, this is my heart this morning. Oh God, will thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Amen. It's been said so many times, and I believe it, that we are to be the most happiest people on the face of the earth. Yes, when we're going through tribulations, knowing that God will not allow nothing to come upon us that we cannot bear. And that if God has allowed it to come upon us, he will give us grace to accept it. And something wonderful and beautiful can come out of that. Because we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And thou hast taken away all of thy wrath. Thou hast turned thyself from the fierceness of thy anger. He says, turn us, O God. Oh, friends, this is my cry this morning. Turn us, O God. Turn us, O God, from the way that we're walking in, and put us back on the path of righteousness and holiness. Amen. Sometimes we just slip off the path that God has set before us. You know the path, that narrow path that Jesus talked about in Matthew 7, verses 13 and 14, that leads into heaven. He also talked about that broad road that many that are on, that leads to destruction.
Oh, will thou not revive us again that thy people may rejoice in thee? Save us or show us thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation. And you know, I've explained this word salvation to the church, but maybe you're watching by the way of Facebook or YouTube, or maybe you're here and you've never heard me explain it, but the word salvation is used in two different ways in the Bible. As for instance, when you think about that word salvation in the Old Testament, it's a reference to being delivered physically from danger. Again, as you think about Exodus 14, verse 13, when God delivered his people from Egypt by the hands of Moses, they came to the Red Sea. And it looked like there was no hope because the enemy was fastly closing in on them. But Moses says, stand still and fear not and see the salvation of the Lord. And God told Moses to reach forth his hands over the sea. And as he did, the Red Sea opened and that God's people crossed safely. So he's making a reference here when he uses the word salvation, deliver us physically speaking. But you know, when you come into the New Testament, you see that same word salvation, but it's used in a different way. As for instance, when Luke said in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's talking about the spiritual deliverance of man's soul from the bondage of sin. So, as we look at this word salvation, we can see it being used here in verse 9 in two different ways, physically and spiritually. Surely his salvation is nigh to them that fear him, that the glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth are meet together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. So when we look at the whole passage here, not only does it look back at God's goodness that he's had on his people, but he looks at the present knowing that because of this destruction was their own making. They had sinned against God. They had rebelled against God. And God continued to call his people back, but they refused to listen. So therefore, God went to the extreme and how he chose the heathen nation to bring judgment upon his people. He sent even Jeremiah the prophet. Jeremiah came to him. And he says in chapter 3, verse 14, turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you. And I will take you one of a city and two of a family, and I will bring you to Zion. But they would not listen. He goes on to say in chapter 6, verse 16, stand ye in the way and see, and ask for the old path, where is the good way? And walk therein, ye shall find peace for their souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. Also, I sent a watchman over you, saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we will not hearken. Amen. Because of their sin, because of their stubbornness, God chose a heathen nation, a nation that was more wicked than God's people, to bring judgment upon them. So the psalmist sees that because of this destruction, because of their holy city, the temple, the walls, because it's all been destroyed, was their own making. But then he looks to the future where Israel will dwell safely in their land, where their land will yield a great increase. He's looking without a doubt towards the millennial kingdom. But as we know, before that happens, Israel, along with the earth dwellers, will go through another great tribulation. A tribulation as no man has ever experienced. Jesus says that no man he says there have never been a time like this, or never will be a time like this. He went on to say, if I shouldn't shorten those days, no flesh would be saved.
And we're talking about the 7-year tribulation period that the Bible speaks of in Revelation chapter 6 through 18. And we challenge people today, get right with God or get left behind. And friends, you don't want to be here when the church is taken out and you're going through the tribulation period. You don't want to be here. So not only is Israel in future times going to go through another great tribulation period, but all of earth dwellers, those that has rejected God, those that has rejected Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. Oh, listen. We find a plea for revival. Walter Bowett said this about revival. He said, revival is God working to restore His church back to health. A lot of times when we think about revival, we think, well, you know, we're going to have some good preaching, a good singing. But let me tell you something, friends. Revival means so much more than that. Yeah. Oh, listen, I love good preaching. I love good singing. But revival is a time that God intervenes on the behalf of His people. It is for God's people. Even though we have seen lost people benefit from revivals, they come to revivals, they hear the gospel, their heart is pricked, and they call upon the name of the Lord and they're saved. But revival is for the church. It is when God is doing something very special among His people. You know, oftentimes I've heard stories and I've read stories and testimonies of years gone by, how revivals came and how multitude of peoples were saved out of that. And I thought to myself, you know, wouldn't it be great that if America could experience a revival? I mean, revival is for the church. But friends, would you not agree that this country needs a great movement of God? We need God to intervene. Amen. Friends, is it possible for our country? And you know, listen, I don't want to be a negative person, but let me say this. As long as you have this nation legal lies and sin, and as long as you have people living an open life of sin and parading it around as something to be proud of, don't expect it. It's not going to come. Revivals cannot be worked up. They must come down. When God's people meets the conditions, you say, well, what is the conditions? I believe the blueprint for revival is found in 2 Chronicles 7:14. Now, I've had some people say that does not apply to the church today, that only applied to the Jewish people at that time. I disagree. You believe whatever you want to believe. But I believe if you and I, as God's people today, if we would apply 2 Chronicles 7:14, those four principles to our life, you can expect revival. You say, now what is that? The Bible says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sins and will heal their land. Amen. I believe beyond the shadow of a doubt that if God's people, Christian people, would humble themselves and begin to pray and begin to confess sins and seek God and forsake sinful habits and practices, God would intervene. And friends, listen, that's what we need today. Our churches throughout this country, we need a heaven-sent Holy Ghost revival. We need a revival that's going to shake us up and stir us up a little bit. Amen. Oftentimes, a new awareness of God's character comes through revival. You know, we go back, you can even go back to Psalm 73:1. The psalmist says, truly God is good to Israel, even to such as of a clean heart. Nobody could deny that God was good to Israel and that God was good to all that would seek Him and live by His holy standards and laws and precepts. The psalmist looks back
He sees God, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God that delivered his people from Egypt's bondage, the God that would years later roll back the Jordan River to enter into the promised land, the same God that would destroy cities and giants on the behalf of God's people, were that was the same God that they had sinned and rebelled against. Y'all don't mind if I preach a little bit, do you? You know, when you think about God's character, He is holy. He is righteous. He is good. He is merciful. He is long-suffering. He is more than willing to forgive and to pardon our sins. But He's also a God that can be provoked to anger. Righteous, righteous anger. And it is seen throughout the Old Testament. The Bible says in Hebrews 10:31, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. The Bible says in Hebrews 12:29, for our God is a consuming fire. Oh, listen, David said in Psalms 7:11, the Lord is angry with the wicked every day. The Lord loves sinners, but He hates sin. One of my favorite preachers of all time is in the heavenlies, Brother Adrian Rogers. I still listen to him. His ministry is still alive today. But he said something one time that I'll never will forget, and oftentimes I'll quote it. But he said, men's sins are like water that's pressing upon a dam. And one of these days, that dam is going to break. And men's sins today is pressing upon the dam of God's mercies. He is long-suffering. But there will come a day where the dam of His mercies will break. Amen. God does not delight in having to judge people in the nations. We provoke Him to that. Amen. And friends, today we look around in our country again as we have lawmakers that's legalizing sin and people parading the sin. And if that wasn't bad enough, we're seeing churches bow their knee and accepting sin into their congregations. Amen. And yes, sir, I'm talking about same-sex marriage. God have mercy. God have mercy on churches that accepts sin. When you accept sin, you're pushing the Lord Jesus Christ right to the curb, and you can write that down. Amen. Our churches need a heaven-sent Holy Ghost revival. I mean, we need the Holy Spirit to come in the clean house. Amen. That's exactly what we need today. Listen, oftentimes when revival comes, it brings a new awareness of God's holy character. Again, as we think about Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, the Bible says that Uzziah the king had died, Isaiah said that I saw the Lord high and lifted up, sitting upon the throne, and His glory filled the temple. God was showing to Isaiah that although Uzziah was a great king, that he reigned for many years, there's somebody that's above him. That's somebody that is a greater king than Uzziah was. And yes, sir, I'm talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. Amen. So when revival oftentimes brings a new awareness of God's character, it awakens the conscience of Christians. And friends, today, Christians, our conscience needs to be awoken. I feel like the devil has rocked many of us asleep. You remember the story about Samson and Delilah? And Delilah, that devil woman? Yes, sir. Old Samson laid in the lap of the devil. He told her his secrets, and she called men in, and while he slept in her lap, the men cut the locks of hair off of Samson and snuck back out and waited for him to ambush him. And then she says, "Awake, Samson, awake, the Philistines are here." And he says, "I will go out and shake myself as often times I have." And he went out not knowing that the Spirit and the power of God had That's the condition we see a lot of churches today, as we accept and embrace sin, not knowing that the power and the Spirit of God has departed from that place. Yeah. If my Bible says that God does not accept sin, that means He does not accept sin today. Amen. He loves the sinner, but He will not accept or embrace sinful behavior of His people. If God judged His people then you can write it down. He'll judge them still today. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He never changes. His views concerning sin never changes. You see, friends, again, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sins and will heal their land.
Oh, not only do we need our churches to be healed, I want our land to be healed from all of this innocent, precious blood from aborted babies. Let me tell you something. If I don't sit good with Facebook, then go ahead and feel free to delete me. Abortion is not a woman's choice. It's simple. It's murder in the worst degree. Amen. And God hates the hands of those that shed innocent blood. You might not like me getting a little loud, but you have to take it up with God, because the Holy Spirit's all over me this morning. We want revival. We want God to do something for us, but we're not willing to pay the price for it. Yeah. Did you know that of all the conflict and of all the trouble that churches has today, it's not coming from without, it's coming from within? Yeah. And we wonder why we can't have revival. Let me say something, friends. It's simple. It's simple when you think about it. People that's in the house of God, not all of them, thank God, not all of them, but there's a lot of people that attends church and they've got anger and hatred and resentment and unforgiveness in their heart, but yet they expect God to bless them. They expect to have a Holy Ghost heaven sent revival. You're going to have to get right with God. Yeah. Oftentimes when we talk about revival, we might say, boy, so-and-so needs revival. No, it's you. You need revival. I need revival. Yeah. I was talking to my wife. My wife asked a question about what kind of message I was preparing or fixing to preach. And I said something, I don't know how it was or our conversation went, but I said, you know, honey, I've got to preach to self first. Before anybody else receives the preaching of God's word, David needs it. So does every other preacher, pastor, evangelist. Amen. Oh, listen to me. Will thou not revive us again, O God, that thy people may rejoice in thee? We need our conscience awoke. Peter says in the last days, people's hearts will be seared like a hot iron. They cannot receive the things of God. Oh, listen, we think about those seven churches in the book of Revelation, chapter 2 and chapter 3, that Jesus examined. Those seven churches that there was there in Asia Minor. And only two of those churches He could commend for their faith and for their works. The other five churches He strongly rebuked for them, or rebuked them, and He challenged them to repent unless He comes and He removes their candlestick. God's presence from those churches. But one of the churches that we often refer to is the Church of Laodicea, right? Because we have pretty much the same characteristics of the Church of Laodicea. But did you know that Jesus said in Revelation 3:15, He says, I know thy works, that thou art not hot or cold. I would that thou was hot or cold. But because thou art lukewarm, I will spew thee out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. And He says, knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Oh yeah, they increased with goods
And they said, we have need of nothing. And their greatest need was God. And I'm saying today, friends, your greatest need, the greatest need today in our land is God. Oh, I'm not preaching this the way I thought I would. You know, Jesus said in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man heareth my voice and opens the door, I will come into him, sup with him, and he with me. Who is Jesus talking to? He's talking to his own church. How the church has accepted and embraced sin and in a sense pushed him on out. And Jesus stands knocking, wanting back in. Oh, we need our conscience awakened today. When it comes to sin and how devastating sin is to the Christian. And then once a conscience is awoke, then a renewal of Christian obedience is in order. Look in our text in verse 8. Look what he says here. He says, I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints, but let them not turn again to folly or foolishness or sin. You know, he has a different attitude towards now, towards God now. Before, they was in the act of rebellion, sin. They told the man of God they are not going to hear what he has to say. And you know what, friends? Isn't it something that oftentimes God goes to the extreme to get his people's attention? We can become so stubborn, so sinful that we're like, I don't want to hear it, God. I'm going to do my own thing. And God loves you so much that sometimes he'll go through the extreme to get your attention. Oh yeah, the Bible says in Hebrews 12:7, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scorneth every son whom he receiveth. There have been times in my life that God has got a hold of my attention, but it led me to a Christian obedience from that very moment on. David Dean said, revival brings power to the powerless. Amen. Oh, will thou not revive us again, O God, that thy people may rejoice in thee. The people had lost. They lost their freedom. They lost their liberty. They lost their relationship with God. They lost their joy, their happiness, their peace. Someone said that during this time that they just simply hung their harps upon the willow. It's hard to praise God when you're in bondage. You know, King David, he said there in Psalms 51:12, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and uphold me with thy free spirit. Well, again, you know the word revive, it means to restore. David lost something when he chose to sin and rebel against God, didn't he? He lost that joy of God's fellowship. He lost that joy and that peace. And friends, today, it is very evident today that many Christians has lost their joy when it comes living and serving God. They have no more joy. Amen. They have no more joy. And God is ready to restore the joy and all those things that has been lost. He stands ready and willing to restore all if we come to the place of repentance. And then last but not least, I'm going to wrap it up here. A revival brings a fresh view, if you please, concerning lost souls. You know, In every church, no matter what size the church is, there's only 5 to 10% goes out evangelizing. That's remarkable when you think about it. Only 5 to 10% of all churches, the memberships, goes out evangelizing. You know, in Matthew 28:19-20, again, the Bible says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. That's the Great Commission. You want to know why it's called the Great Commission? Because of all of the endeavors the church can be engaged in, there is none any greater than taking the gospel to the highways and hedges, to the lost and undone and dying world. There's no mission greater. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, right before Jesus was taken back up into the heavenlies, he looked upon them and he says, but he shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And he shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost part of the earth. God has called you and I as believers to be a witness of his grace and forgiveness. For us to go forth preaching the gospel to every creature. That is our responsibility. That is our duty. And oftentimes during revivals, we have a fresh perspective concerning our role that God's called us in to be a witness. Amen. Nothing any greater than that. And you know what, friends? Listen, when we think about revival, as we begin tonight, I like to think revival has already begun. Amen. But this should be our earnest prayer. Revive me, O God. Revive me. As far as the nation, I don't believe the nation is ever going to experience a revival because there's too much pleasure in sin. God would have to do something dramatic to bring this nation to our knees for us to begin to cry out for God. But listen, God wants to revive his church. God wants to revive us as individuals. We can expect that. If you really hunger for it, God will revive us. That is his will. I want you to stand with me as far as we feel led to go. As we have preached on revival, there might be somebody here today, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you don't have fellowship with God. Maybe you're watching by the way of Facebook or YouTube. I didn't ask you if you was a member of a church. I didn't ask you if you was baptized. I asked you, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Friends, that is man's only hope today. Jesus says he must be born again, spiritually speaking. Oh, friends, listen, I urge you today to call upon God, for whosoever shall call upon him shall be saved. Would you call upon Jesus today? Would you ask Christ to come into your heart to forgive you and to save your soul? Would you dedicate your life to Jesus today? That's the only hope that we have, is to spend eternity in the kingdom of God with Christ. I hope that you'll do that. And I hope that you'll come out and be a part of our revival, okay? Until next Sunday, may God bless you.